Hello, everybody. I'm Rob Anthony Dyer, your host of Rad Radio, and it brings me great pleasure to have a very special guest today, one of my all-time favorite actresses, the lovely, the talented, and the super amazing Tracy Bregman. How are you, Tracy?
Good. How are you all? Here on Sucky Monday?
Exactly. Now, today was your first day back to work, was it not?
We usually don't tape on Mondays. We usually tape Tuesday through Friday. And we were dark last week.
Ah, so it's back to the grind tomorrow.
Yep, back tomorrow for the first time.
Well, I really appreciate you taking some time out to do my show. It means a lot to me. And I have to say, I've been loving your current storyline. It's been absolutely great having you front and center with something new, no Carters involved, and you're in the credits, and you have so many other projects going on, so we do have a lot to talk about. Now, I did go back and do some research about your early career, and I stumbled upon the episode of Fame that you shot back in the 80s, and I do remember seeing it as a kid, but I didn't remember how powerful it was. That must have been a great experience.
It was so much fun. Oh, my God, did I have a great time. What was so funny is that I had been a dancer for years, and dancer, and I sort of sang, and I thought, I'm finally doing Fame. I can't believe it. And I end up being a writer violinist. When they found out that I could dance a little, they put me in the end number.
Yeah, when I watched that recently, it brought back memories of the first time I saw it, and you really can dance. Now, what year was that?
I'm trying to think. It was before Young and Restless, so it might have been 82.
That would make sense. I vaguely do remember it, and I loved the show, but my parents had to make me stop watching it because I actually broke a couch. I would try to recreate the dance numbers, and I destroyed the springs.
That's so funny. It was everyone was so talented, and oh, my God, it was great. And, that was the one episode that Laurie Singer didn't do. That's when she was doing Footloose.
Okay, that makes perfect sense. I didn't realize at the time, but that show was so well written, and I believe ahead of its time, but there was just so much to that episode and so many parallel themes. It was just really amazing.
It was really good, and working with Debbie Allen was tremendous, and Gene Anthony Ray was extraordinary. He was one of the most extraordinary people I've ever worked with, and talk about talented. Oh, my God. I mean, just from the original Fame, and then, of course, the show, it was so good.
Well, that was one of the very first notable performances of your career, and, of course, shortly thereafter, you landed the role in The Young and the Restless. Now, do you remember the exact date that you started?
January, it was, I think, 21st, 22nd of 83.
Well, congratulations on over 30 years on the show.
Yeah, I can't even believe it.
Which I don't see how it's possible because you look like you're only in your 30s. And I'm not kidding. I mean, it's unbelievable.
God bless you.
Now, where would people be able to find some of your health and beauty secrets? Because I'm sure many people would not mind looking as great as you do.
It's all in the blog.
Well, speaking of your blog, I do indeed follow it. And I gotta say, I really love it. You do an amazing job.
Thank you.
Hey, I speak the truth. I think everybody should follow it. Conscious Living is the name. And if people subscribe, they'd get every new entry delivered straight to their email so they don't have to worry about searching and finding out when you add a new entry. Now, tell me, Tracy, a lot of your recipes look amazingly delicious and nutritious, but not everybody is able to get a lot of those ingredients easily depending on where they live in the country. Do you have any suggestions for them?
What's really great is Amazon.com, you know, including weird stuff for my chickens. So if there's anything weird, just go on Amazon.com.
Great advice. I have come to rely on them heavily. Now, I love the pictures you tweeted recently about what you bought for your chickens.
Oh, my God. When two huge boxes arrived and they were all freeze-dried worms, I usually get them the crickets and the worms. But this time, I couldn't find it with the crickets, so they were so, you know, deprived. They just got the worms. Actually, it's so disgusting looking that I try desperately not to, like, think about what it is. You know? So gross.
Well, I bet many people are very surprised to hear that, considering that you play the glamorous Lauren Fenmore Baldwin on The Young and the Restless. So this is a whole other side to you.
My family, they have a ranch outside of the city of Toronto, kind of far, a couple of hours outside. And I love to go stay with them, but they have like 3 horses, 40 chickens, turkeys, geese, and 6 peacocks, and I mean, and then of course the 6 dogs and the 20 cats and all of that. And I marvel at how they do it, you know, and I'm like overwhelmed with 4 chickens and 3 dogs. But, no, it was so much fun to stay with them.
One of the reasons that Lauren is pretty much my favorite character is that she has evolved over the years. But I do remember in the early years where she was extremely mean to Tracy, played by Beth Maitland. So I was just wondering how difficult it was for you to do those scenes, because I know in real life you're a super nice person.
Oh, no, it was awful. I mean, the only thing that was really difficult about that, as much as I loved all those storylines, is sometimes Bill Bell would write dialogue that was so mean that I would have to say to Beth, and Beth and I were so close, and I was like, oh, God, how am I going to say this to her? And it's so not me to say stuff like that, that I was like, oh, God. Sometimes a couple of the shows were so mean that she and I would both be crying before, you know, we had to do the scenes. It was a little rough.
Well, I was very happy and pleasantly surprised a couple of years ago when they wrote the scene where Lauren and Tracy reconcile. Because, as you know, soap operas over the years with changing of writers tend to sometimes forget the past history. And fans remember, so I thought that was amazing.
Beth and I stayed very good friends, and we loved that they did that. And I think everyone who watches, really, they were like, it was great that they went full circle. Yeah. We have very, very smart people who watch us.
Well, I guess I'll agree with that to a point. Now, again, one thing I love about Lauren is she has grown and changed over the years, but she does make mistakes, as we know from the recent storyline where she cheated on Michael.
This is not the first husband she's cheated on.
That's right. I do remember those very steamy scenes where she cheated on Scott with Brad.
With Brad and with Paul. I know that the audience is now all of a sudden not liking me, you know. The audience is divided. I try to do it from a sympathetic point of view.
Oh, I think you totally do. Now, do you think that the fact that some people are having trouble with the storyline is possibly because it hits close to home?
For me, and what I've tried to say when people really come at me, oh, I'm now hating your character. And I'm like, well, I just so you know, as an actress, I'm loving the storyline. I'm
right.
So happy to have something to do in that. Believe me, I think it's so beautifully written, and sometimes the scenes are so real that it's painful to do. I know that they were getting upset, but, you know, I think for a little bit what was interesting is that people maybe could understand how she was upset at Michael with what happened with Fenn, and that was sort of cool that people were sort of divided. I loved when people thought I was so blind as a mother to think that Fenn couldn't do it, and then when it turned out that he didn't do it, I was like, ah, ha, ha, ha. I think when she did turn to the cheating, listen, you know, we don't ever want to think that people do that, but, well, the reality of the situation is something intrinsically got broken between Lauren and Michael, and we never thought that would happen. But it did. She's not handling it in the best possible way, for sure. But, you know, I think what will happen from here will be interesting, to say the least.
Well, I think that the online bullying story with Fenn really hits home with people as well. And the writers have done a great job writing for you and Christian and Max. And this story has come full circle, and the ramifications are still going on months and months later.
I'm doing scenes tomorrow that we're shooting. You won't see them for 4 weeks, but they are so beautifully written. I'm just so excited for this writing and the stories and the opportunity to do emotional story that I think when you say it hits home, it's true. You know, we're not doing storylines that people can't really relate to and have emotional reactions to. And that's good. We like that.
Well, I like it too. And I've noticed with the new writing, you've been very, very expressive with your eyes and your facial expressions. And it does make me think back to that famous farmhouse scene with Sheila, where your mouth is completely duct taped, and you told me before you found out you were allergic to duct tape that way. And on that scene, all you could do was show your fear and terror with your eyes. And you're doing that so well right now with your guilt. It's really amazing. The Lauren-Sheila rivalry is probably one of the most popular soap rivalries in history. But I am so happy that you have something different. You have a Carter-free and a Sheila-free and a Sheila-Spawn-free storyline.
Right. For me to have something that doesn't involve that is really cool. And I couldn't be happier.
Well, I was definitely a huge fan of the Lauren-Sheila storylines, but you can't really have two characters permanently tethered to each other, or else there's really not much for them to do when they're not together. Which kind of leads me to my next question. Is it a lot more inspiring and rejuvenating now that you have such a great story? Because for a long time, you were Michael's supportive wife or Sheila's best friend. But unless there was a spawn of Sheila around, you weren't front and center. So I can totally see it in your acting now.
Well, thank you. As I said, I could not be happier with this storyline. And you're right. And I'm, as much as I did enjoy the Sheila stuff, I'm so happy to be part of a non-Sheila story.
Now, most characters or couples on soaps end up getting married, then they marry other people, but then they remarry each other. I think Michael and Lauren possibly have one of the longest unbroken soap marriages in history. And if you factor in the aging of Fenn, it's even longer.
Well, we started to do this storyline, and we were celebrating what I thought was like our sixth wedding anniversary, and we both looked at each other and went, oh, it's not. And now I just had a line where Fenn is 18. And I was like, Jesus, how long? So we both had to talk about, all right, you know, a 6-year marriage or 7-year marriage is different than a 20-year marriage. So we sort of had to reconfigure how our marriage was and where we were in it. Somebody said they'd need therapy if we broke up, and I said, quite frankly, I'll be on the couch next to you.
Now, do you find that the sex scenes lately have become a lot steamier than they used to be? I think they had more scenes in the 80s, but now there's a lot more graphic content. And then, of course, there's Marco, who never has a shirt on.
Here's what I say whenever he's shirtless. I'm like, better you than me, honey. You know, it's so funny because we always look at the next week. We'll say goodbye to each other on Friday, and we're like, are we naked next week?
Now, was there any sort of awkward transitional period after only doing love scenes with Christian for so many years that you had to kind of get used to another person?
Is this different working with different actors? You still have your own personal space, but when someone then breaks that personal space wall, then that's a whole new thing to get used to. And then, of course, you have to kiss somebody. You know, then you have to have, like, the conversation. All right, well, we're doing this here. How do you want to do it? What are your boundaries? What do you, you know? Because we had major love scenes. Is the actor uncomfortable with certain things? What makes them comfortable? And then you sort of have to find how the two of you will be comfortable in any given situation. It couldn't be a more uncomfortable thing to do in front of 40 crew guys. You know, my poor crew, you know, during the love scenes, they wanted, like, to see a lot of back, and everything kept slipping out, and poor Marco had everything kind of on top of him, and, you know, it's different because, actually, Christian and I have never had to do anything that naked. And it was sort of like, hey, Marco, I'm so glad you're back to the show, and oh my God, I'm naked. So it was an interesting thing. In the 80s when I started, if you saw too much of my back, they literally would have to redo the scenes. And now there was an, you know, now everything's kind of strategically placed, but I seem to remember, I know that a few of the girls have done a lot of bra and underwear. Michelle's always naked. I think it was very funny that they were deciding how much of my back to show while I was doing these love scenes. And I'm like, excuse me, you know, a couple of these girls walk around in bras and underwear, and I think that shows more than my back. Yeah, definitely. I did a lot of love scenes during the whole Don Diamante's. What's so funny is back then, Don was always saying, I can't believe my butt is out. You know, he was always saying, why is it always my butt that's out? Very funny. I said, well, those were my notes. I don't know about anybody else. But
now, there's a question I've been wanting to ask you for quite some time. I read an article in one of the soap magazines where it said a character, an actor being dropped from contract to recurring used to be the kiss of death, but they actually mentioned you specifically. They said Tracy Bregman was the game changer because I think you've been recurring for 12 years and you get as much, if not more, screen time than some of the contracted actors, which of course makes me very happy. Could you just explain to our listeners what the technical differences are between contract and recurring on soaps?
I was poster child for it because different actors asked to go on recurring, I would always get the phone call first. Technical thing is that when you're under contract, you have a certain guarantee of show. With recurring, you have no guarantee. You don't get raises. And in contracts, sometimes you do, sometimes you don't. So that's all kind of negotiated. I got really, really lucky that that I worked as much as that I did, not under contract. But, you know, I had not wanted to do it at one point because I started to travel a lot with my family. And when you're under contract, you can't do that. And then in the last couple of years, I started traveling a lot just for work and branding. Mm-hmm. So I wasn't sure that I'd be able to do both. And I was assured that I could. So it made sense. Mm-hmm. And of course, when Jill asked me, yeah, they are doing amazing. And so there was no reason to say no.
Now, some of our listeners may not be aware, but you actually design your very own jewelry line. And it's not some knockoff faux diamond fool's gold thing. I'm talking real gold, real gemstones. I actually was able to watch a live broadcast on the Shopping Channel because it's not actually available yet in the United States. But I got to tell you, Tracy, your stuff is gorgeous.
Thank you. You know, it's been a great journey for the last, you know, 2.5 years. And I'm just about to debut in the next few months. A very personal jewelry line in the United States that Ooh. There will be a link on my blog for.
Cool.
I'm very, very excited about it.
Now, the stuff I saw on the Shopping Channel was for women, but I would be very interested in a ring for myself. And I know that you did ask people to tweet you what finger they like to wear rings on and what stones they like. I personally like Labradorite, which is your favorite, and I like it on my middle finger. Now, we don't actually have the Canadian Shopping Channel on television here, but we are able to watch it live streaming online. So if someone's watching online, can't they find a way to order it?
Hey, that's the thing. If you're in the U.S., you can't purchase any of the Canadian stuff. That's why I'm going to do a separate line specifically for the United States and international. What's going to happen is under conscious living, you're all the things that go under that feel for me. Like I'm working on a very small clothing line, all done of natural fiber, like bamboo and cashmere and stuff like that. So that's coming. The jewelry line's coming. Everything's coming. Hopefully the jewelry line will be up within 2 months and jewelry within 6. You know, the whole conscious living means so much to me. It really is the way that I live. It's the way that I dress. It's the jewelry that I love. And by doing it myself, I have a little bit more say. Yeah. So it'll be very much my style. I can't wait to premiere it.
Well, we will definitely help you promote it. Now, I'm not sure if a lot of listeners know this, but you raise hens, and you told me before that you have a luxury hen house. I'm still waiting for that picture, by the way, of you in a gown with a pitchfork doing the Ava Gabor thing.
One of the Vogue photographers is coming over to photograph me in the next couple weeks, and I'll make sure we do that for you.
Well, I'm very honored, and you're so sweet. And speaking of special pictures you've taken for me, I really want to thank you for the pics that you had taken for me at the YNR 40th anniversary. That was so nice of you, and you look gorgeous in all of them.
Thank you. I used all those pictures.
Well, they were great pictures, and I think you're okay since I believe you have every right to use your own image however you see fit.
Oh, but I appreciate it.
Well, I really appreciate it, and I appreciate you. And I was just wondering, can I ask you one last question before you go? I want to know how somebody as busy as you, with so many projects going on, finds the time to interact with people so much. I mean, I can't even think of any celebrity on Twitter who interacts with their fans and people as much as you do. And Facebook messages, I remember about 2.5 years ago, I messaged you on Facebook, never expecting a reply, and you replied right back, and I think we had a conversation, and I was like, wow, Tracy's really cool. How do you find the time?
So sweet. You know, it's so funny because my boyfriend will tell you that at night when I go to wash my face before bed, that I go into the vortex because it takes me so long. And what he doesn't realize is I'm doing all my social media. Right. He calls it the vortex. I do that, you know, I do a lot at night. And I'm just, you know, if I have 1 minute free, even if I'm, you know, waiting for somebody for a meeting or a restaurant, I'm answering because I really love to answer people, especially, you know, when people have questions about the jewelry or they're tweeting things about, oh, I wore it with this. Do you like it with this outfit? I really like to be on top of everything because if I go on my Twitter and see, oh my God, I have 65 questions, I feel bad if I don't get to answer everybody. So I try and go on as much as possible to answer. And, you know, everybody who tweets with me and Facebooks and all of that are very important to me. So I want to make sure that I'm on top of it. You know, everybody that watches is who keeps us on the air. And that, I mean, when you guys have a personal emotional investment, like we have a personal investment in our show, that makes it all the better. And to let people know how grateful we are on a daily basis that they, you know, you have a lot of choices and you pick up the remote and there are hundreds of channels that you can choose. And when you choose ours, I think it's important that you hear from us how grateful we are.
Since the show has been available online, I have not missed a single episode. So there's more ways people can watch now, too. And again, Tracy, you are just amazing. I think you're a great person. And one of your former castmates is a good friend of mine, and I won't say who, but she told me that you are one of the most down-to-earth, genuine people in show business. And I think she's right. Again, I really want to thank you for taking the time to do the show. I know you're very busy. And just thank you for being you.
Well, have a great night, you guys.
You too, Tracy. It's been an absolute pleasure.
Good night.